Perfect.
Okay, so let me start by, of course, thanking the organizers, Raul, Francesco, and Luca for organizing this very nice workshop. Today I'm going to talk about the results of a couple of works, mostly about black holes in asymptotically safe gravity. These are the results of a paper I wrote a couple of years ago, and some new results that are slightly more general and are based on a work in progress with another postdoc at Perimeter and Benjamin Plour, and that will hopefully will out soon. Okay, so why do we need alternatives to black holes? We know from the framework of general relativity that while it works extremely well on large scales, general relativity is affected by space-time singularities. In the cosmological space-times, in the cosmological evolutions, and inside black holes. And the presence of singularities implies a loss of physical predictivity. One cannot go through the singularities of general relativity. And from this follows the common saying that general relativity predicts its own breakdown. And if we want to achieve singularity resolution, one has to modify something. For instance, singularity resolution could be achieved within a full theory of quantum gravity. That's indeed one of the reasons why one advocates quantum gravity. I would like to find a theory of quantum gravity. Or there could be some exotic matter that allows for a violation of the energy condition. But at any rate, one needs some sort of new physics to achieve singularity resolutions. And in principle, there are various alternatives to black holes, to classical black holes, that are, as also Stefano discussed, regular black holes, wormholes, compact objects, and there are several types of fastballs, gravastars, boson stars, and so on. And in this talk, I will mostly focus on regular black holes in a specific theory, in a specific approach to quantum gravity. So in particular, we'll discuss black holes in asymptotically safe gravity. And assuming that not everyone in the audience knows about this approach, let me say a couple of words about this. So it is asymptotically safe gravity is one of the many approaches to quantum gravity. And I think it can be considered as one of the most conservative as the framework where the language of asymptotically safe gravity is the language of quantum field theory. And what adds to quantum field theory is non-perturbative renormalization or non-perturbative techniques of the functional renormalization group. And this is inspired by the Wilsonian idea of renormalization and the fact that renormalizability is according to Wilsonian renormalization associated with the existence of ultraviolet attractive fixed points for the renormalization group flow. And indeed, it was Weinberg in 1986 to suggest that eventually gravity could make sense as a quantum field theory if such a fixed point exists. The question is not settled yet, but there are some evidence in this respect. So there are computations within approximation that seems to show that such a fixed point could exist. But now, since asymptotic safety stays within the framework of quantum field theory, how would quantum replacement to classical black holes arise. This essentially boils down to the fully quantum dynamics that is encoded in the effective action that comes essentially by resumming all quantum fluctuations. So one should, in principle, resum all quantum fluctuations, for instance, by computing the functional integral and obtaining what is the quantum equivalent to the classical axon. That, however, while it has a classical appearance, it already includes all quantum effects. And those, what one could do is to compute the corresponding effective field equations. And among the solutions to these fully quantum field equations, one would also get something that could, in principle, replace classical black holes. And this is what one would like to do, but the state of the art at the moment is that the quantum effective action is not known. So in the past 20 years from the 90s, essentially alternative methods have been employed to try to understand how the replacement of black holes in asymptotic safety would look like. And in order to do so, a key observation is that the asymptotic safety that is based on the eventually the existence of the fixed point, an ultraviolet fixed point that acts as a UV completion for gravity, is strictly related to the anti-screening effects of gravity at high energies. And while this is related to the existence of a UV attractive fixed point, a non-trivial fixed point, because then the theory would be interacting and not free, a naive way to see this is by looking at the running, the renormalization group running of the Newton coupling. And this is because the running of the Newton coupling would follow essentially this trajectory for low values of the typical momentum scale. The Newton coupling is constant and given by the usual inverse Planck mass square. But close to the fixed point regime, where the dimensionless counterpart to the Newton coupling approaches a fixed constant value, then the Newton coupling would scale as an inverse momentum square. And this would essentially make the dimensionful Newton coupling vanish in the ultraviolet. And so this is a good pictorial way to think of these anti-screening effects of gravity in the context of asymptotic safety. And said so, how do we get black hole solutions without the effective action? Is there any way around? And the idea that has been used was essentially stolen from calculations in quantum field theory. And as an example is that of quantum electrodynamics, the renormalization group improvement in quantum electrodynamics, where one is able to get the one loop cooling potential by starting from the classical potential, replacing the electric charge with the corresponding running coupling that is in turn obtained by solving the beta functions for the electric charge or equivalently the fine structure constant. And then one, in the case of QED, identifies this momentum scale with an inverse length scale. And this gives essentially the a good approximation to the quantum potential to one loop. And the idea, since at the moment, no approximation for the effective action that are known was to do something similar for gravity and try to see what comes out. So in the next slide, I'm going to review what is the idea, how this applies to the case of gravity and what has been done essentially in the past years. So one would start from the classical solutions, as in the case of the classical electric potential. And in this case, this would be simply the Schwarzschild metric. So now I'm considering the case of static spherically symmetric solutions. So the metric looks like this. And the Laplace function is given by the usual form. And this metric with this Laplace function is solution to the vacuum Einstein equations. And the corresponding Newtonian potential would look like this. So it is it diverges at the would be singularity at r equal to zero. And one what would like to have is to reproduce, of course, general relativity at large scales. So here one would still have a Newton coupling that is our standard constant Newton coupling. But close to the singularity, one would expect some modifications to take place. And for instance, if gravity is asymptotically safe and if we can associate this regime with the fixed point regime of asymptotically safe gravity, then the Newton coupling scales according to the fixed point scaling that I have shown you before. And the interpolation between these two regimes is just given by this function that one can obtain by solving the beta functions for the Newton coupling. And now what one would do is to try to do the same as one would do in quantum electrodynamics. So one starts from this solution and replace the constant Newton coupling with a running Newton coupling. And now this K square in the case of quantum electrodynamics was more was simply one over R length scale. But in the case of GR, this might be more involved. There might be several scales at work. And what Alfio Bonanno and Martin Reuter did in this paper was to identify K with the inverse of the proper distance that would be, in this case, the replacement of the simple radial coordinate that was used in quantum electrodynamics. And if one does so, then one obtains this type of function, this type of G R-dependent Newton coupling that has to be replaced here. And it is, as you can see, an Hayward like black hole. Actually, it was derived earlier than Hayward paper on regular black holes. But now, there are some problems related to these pictures. And some of them are the following, because in comparison with quantum electrodynamics, the case of gravity is much more involved. So first of all, the renormalization group scale, radial coordinate dependent, renormalization group scale would depend, would be constructed using a background metric. It needs the metric to be constructed. But the starting metric is the Schwarzschild metric. And the Schwarzschild metric, we know that it cannot be valid in the strong curvature regime. And it also depends explicitly on the Newton coupling. And in also, once one modifies the solution to the field request, modifies the metric and in particular the Laplace function, the field equations are modified. And this means that in practice, there will be a new solution that could be generated. So this means in practice, one has to take into account back reactions effects or the rounding of the Newton coupling. And this is what I'm going to explain you in the following. So the idea is to modify the entire system self-consistently in order to obtain a self-consistent solution that takes into account the running in a self-consistent way, and the back reaction, of course, of the Newton coupling. And in order to do so, what one can do is just to start as usual, so as one would do in the case of quantum electrodynamics, so modifying Einstein equations and the Laplace function by replacing the Newton coupling with a corresponding Prandtl-Newton coupling and with just starting identification of the cutoff that is not really important. I mean, the specific scaling is not really important. And this automatically modifies the Einstein equations, because once one insert here a function of the radial coordinate, automatically one gets at the level of the effective equation, if one imposes that this is a solution, an effective energy momentum tensor that in this case would have the interpretation of vacuum polarization effects of the quantum gravitational field. And of course, this comes together with an effective energy density that depends on the ratio, on the speed of variation of the Newton coupling. And one can then iterate this procedure, because anytime one modifies the Einstein equations, so one can generate a new identification for this momentum scale. And so this can turn into an iterative procedure, where at every step, the energy momentum tensor and the Laplace function are determined by the previous step. And since, in particular, the momentum square can be generically written in terms of the energy density, and in particular of the variation of the Newton coupling to the previous step, this in the limit where n goes to infinity turns into a closed form differential equation that for some particular scaling, for the some particular identification for the cutoff, for the momentum scale as a function of R, one can just solve it and find a self-consistent solution. Now, I think I will not have time to go into the details, but a good choice in this case is to relate K squared to the energy density. And this comes from the fact that this combination as the interpretation of a regulator for the curvature terms, for the curvature invariance. And using these equations and this particular scaling for the momentum square, one can just solve the corresponding differential equation for this function g. And what one obtains in this case is this type of scaling that some of you might recognize. This corresponds to a Dimnikova black hole, that is a regular black hole, so has all all properties, same properties as Hayward solutions and the Bardeen black holes. So essentially the singularity is replaced by a de Sitter core, and there are two horizons and so on. And so in particular here, what I'm showing answer are two plots where what I show is the ratio of the Newton coupling to the step n over the constant Newton coupling as function of the radial coordinate and the Laplace function for various values of n. So when n is zero, that just corresponds to the case of general relativity, and it's the case of the is depicted as a red line. So the Laplace function diverges negatively and the Newton coupling is constant. But once one turns on the running, first step, one gets the purple lines. So already there is some sort of running for the Newton coupling, some variation with respect to the radial coordinate. And the corresponding Laplace function is already more regular in the sense that at least its value at r equal to zero is finite, but still at the first step, its derivatives are not regular. Once one increases the step, the solution converges rapidly to the Dimnikova solution that is depicted as a black line, and the view is really overlaps with the other steps of the procedure. And this concludes the first part of my talk, that is about how what you would expect in asymptotically safe gravity as a replacement to black holes, but it is based, as I said before, to an alternative methods. In part, in practice, one would like to use the effective action in order to extract black hole solutions. So now I'm going to show you again a slide that I have shown you at the beginning. So what I have shown you is the alternative method that is employed, and in particular, a generalization of it that takes into account the back reaction effects. So this makes it better, but surely it's not free from problems. But there is an interesting question at this point that we can ask, because so it is expected that in asymptotic safety, but also in other theories of quantum gravity, possibly the classical black holes are replaced by some sort of regular black holes, or in any case, object whose metric is does not have some modifications to the Schwarzschild metric. And this object, if one sticks on approaches to quantum gravity that want to reconcile with quantum field theories, and they admit a metric, a description of the spacetimes in terms of an effective metric. And if quantum gravity is supposed to be the key to singularity resolutions with no matter around, then regular black holes or any other object, any other modified metric, would arise as effective solutions to a fully quantum effective dynamics. So there must be solutions to effective field equations that arise from a certain action. And the question is, are there actions that can produce this type of modified solutions? And this question is very difficult to answer in general. So what I'm going to show you is, first of all, a work in progress, and second is the first step in this direction towards answering this question. So just to set up the stage and make things easier, I would consider just a metric of this form, so static spherically symmetric with two different Laplace functions. And I'm assuming that they admit such an asymptotic expansion, okay? Such that, so this would be essentially this term, and this term would be leading order modifications to the Schwarzschild metric. And the reason why I'm assuming that there is such an asymptotic expansion is just that in general, there might be very complicated modification to the Schwarzschild metric, and it is not straightforward at all to derive or understand if there is an effective action reproducing these terms. Now the task is to understand if there is any modification to the action, to the classical action that can generate this term. Because we know that the first part, so the Schwarzschild solution is easily achieved with just the Einstein-Hilbert term. But if there is any modification to the Schwarzschild metric, and if this modification can be asymptotically, can be represented in this way with these corrections to the Schwarzschild, to the Laplace functions, then there must be other terms in the exon. And the question is, what type of modifications to the effective exon can generate corrections to the Schwarzschild metric? Okay, and so now for the presentational purpose, I will just set these two exponents, n, r, and t to n, but one can perform the computations also with different exponents, and the conclusion do not change, so we'll just keep it like this to have more compact equations. And now, what happens if one adds only local terms to the exon? Well, the Einstein-Hilbert term, if one just takes the corresponding field equations, so the variation of this part of the effective exon with respect to the metric, and insert this type of expansion, then asymptotically to the leading order, then it would look like this. It would have a scaling r to minus 2 minus n. And if this has to be a solution to the effective field equations, then the variation of the effective exon with respect to the metric coming from these terms has to cancel exactly this, at least this term. But now, if one takes just local terms and try to compute the contribution from the Stelle term, so r squared plus c squared, one would get a scaling of this type, so r to minus n minus 4. And this obviously cannot cancel the Einstein-Hilbert contribution. If one also add the r cube terms, like all of them, then the leading order contribution would go like r to minus 8. So this in principle can cancel the contribution to the field equations for the GR term, but only specific cases. So in particular, if n is equal to 6, if there are specific coefficients, and still we need no Stelle terms. And even in this case, if we want to buy this, we would need n equal to 6 here. And essentially, this would not correspond to more standard regular black holes like Hayward or Bardeen that admit this type of asymptotic expansion, at least in the asymptotically flat case and the static spherically symmetric solutions. So essentially, it seems like if one adds only local terms, there must be some sort of fine-tuning to allow regular black holes or modified metrics to work, and it only would only work for specific powers of n. So in order to avoid the fine tuning, what one can do is to invoke non-local terms at the level of the effective exon, and in particular terms that can cancel the contribution from general relativity are of this form. So they must be of the 1 over box type at the r squared c squared level with some couplings. And this type of scaling indeed would generate terms like r to minus 2 minus n to leading order that could cancel the term generated by the GR part for the specific values of alpha and beta that one can compute. So this would allow to avoid the fine tuning. So if one has terms of this form in the effective exon, one can possibly have a modified metric that are compatible with this scaling as solutions to modified field equation coming from an exon principle. But the price to pay is that if one wants to avoid this fine tuning and have some black hole solution that come from arises from an exon principle, when one would have large distance no localities of the type 1 over box, that would be already highly constrained. Possibly, I still have to check this. And examples, as I already mentioned, are the Hayward and the Bardeen black holes that could be compatible with this type of, would admit this type of scaling. And so realizing this type of solution might require non-localities of this type. And the Dimnikova black holes would be an exception in the sense that because of the exponential, they would not admit such asymptotic expansion. So they escape these arguments, such as also other black holes that can that have lapse function characterized by transcendental functions. And at this point, I go to my conclusions. So I, in my talk, I discussed black holes and in particular regular black holes first in the, strictly speaking, in the context of asymptotically safe gravity, using a technique, the normalization group improvement that has been used also in the case of is being used in the quantum field theory, where one can check that it works, but in the case of gravity, it is more involved. And in particular, I have shown you how to include back reaction effects that are naturally generated in the case of gravity. And the first step of the iteration is an Hayward-like solution that was indeed found years ago by Alfio Bonanno and Martin Reuter, but that is step one of the iterations. What I did was to set up a self-consistent procedure, an iterative procedure to get a self-consistent solution that takes into account the back reaction of the Newton coupling within the framework of the renormalization group improvement. And turns out that one can solve the equation that I've shown you exactly. It is just a first order differential equation. And it seems like it converges to a Dimnikova black hole with an exponential scaling of the lapse function that has a regular De Sitter coherent. And in the second part of my talk, instead, I discussed something that is, in a sense, more general, because it applies to any theory of quantum gravity that is supposed to, that admits a description in terms of an effective metric. And I asked the question whether one can recover any modification, whether one can obtain modification to the Schwarzschild metric via an effective, via an axon principle from a given effective axon. This is generally a difficult question, so there were some assumptions going in particular, we assumed asymptotically flat spacetimes focused on static and spherically symmetric solutions, which admit an asymptotic expansion in inverse powers of the radial coordinates. And one finds essentially that if one includes only local term, then it's really difficult to realize modification to the Schwarzschild metric unless one fine tune coefficients and the exponents appearing in the modification to the lapse function with respect to Schwarzschild. And if one wants to avoid this fine tuning, then the price to pay is to have non-localities of the Polyakov type, so of the type of 1/1 box at the level of the axon. And this would imply large distance non-localities. I think that this concludes my summary, and I thank you for your attention, and I'm looking forward to your questions.
So thank you very much, Alessia, for your talk. We've got a question by Jay Yu. Go ahead.
Hi, thank you for a very nice talk, some nice talk. So it is very interesting to see that this rapid convergence in the iteration process. But now you have only considered starting point as a Schwarzschild. And so I'm wondering if you start with like black hole solution with matter like Rice and Nordstrom, would there be still such a kind of rapid convergence in the iteration?
So I have to say that I did not check explicitly. So this is actually in the to-do list. But what I can say is that I wouldn't see any reason why the convergence would be slower in the case of Reisner-Nordstrom. But probably it also depends on the initial condition that I put, because as I have shown you, here. So I introduce this scale depend, this radial coordinate dependence at the very first step, where this is something that I choose. And the final solution, of course, does not depend on the initial condition, because what I do to get the final solution is just to solve the question. So in a sense, it's independent of the various step. But if one sticks on following the procedure step by step, then this initial condition matters for the rapidity of convergence. And what I have shown you here is something that I obtained by starting from an initial K identification that goes as 1 over R. If one starts with 1 over R to 100, it is much slower.
Okay, so can I say that if we choose like exponentially decaying solution, exponential decaying function as the initial condition, then you get a much more rapid convergence.
Yes.
Okay, thanks.
So Shinji?
Yes, so thank you very much for the nice talk. So that I'd like to ask about this self-consistent solution. So that you replace the G Newton in the equation, I mean the Einstein equation, by function of position. And
yes.
In this case, the DFO is preserved or broken, or what happens? If it's a Bianchi identity?
That can be preserved, and in particular, if there is no cosmological constant in the system, as it is in this case, then it is the Bianchi identities are actually automatically satisfied.
But the T mu nu is conserved and the G mu nu is conserved, and then the coefficient is a function of space. And then how do you satisfy both of them?
Because essentially they are the fact that the covariant derivative of G mu nu is zero is just a geometrical identity. And the fact the conservation of the energy momentum tensor applies simply comes from the fact that at every step, I make sure that the modified field equation are exactly those giving the modified solutions to that particular step.
Yeah, but then the G Newton is constant, right?
No. One can see that they are automatically satisfied because.
Well, do you have additional term? Maybe.
Where?
Kind of additional term to the say, I mean, either left hand side or right hand side of Einstein equation.
Yes. Here you have the same term. So this is just G mu nu. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Right.
The Einstein tensor, and here you have an effective energy momentum tensor, and this energy momentum tensor is made of you can define it via some functions. So one of these functions is the energy density that depends on the variation of the Newton coupling over G, and the pressure that is related to the second derivative of the Newton coupling, but with a different scaling of R. So essentially it happens that they once you take the covariant derivative of the sum of both, then everything goes to zero.
I understand, I see. In this case, so if you do the same procedure at the level of the axiom, do you get a different result? You are doing this
at the level of the
equation motion. Now, if you do the same thing, I mean, just replacing the G Newton at the level of the axiom, then do you get a different result or
So typically for black holes, If one starts from Schwarzschild records, it is non-trivial how to implement the normalization group improvement at the level of the axon, because then you would need an invariant to perform the identification. You wouldn't replace a function of the radial coordinate at the level of the axon. But the only invariant that appears at the level of the axon to the step one is the Ricci scalar, which is zero in the case of Schwarzschild black holes. So that is not really, I think it is not doable at the level of the axon for black holes. Or if there is a way around, I'm not aware of it.
I see. Yeah. Thank you very much.
So thank you very much, Alessia, Stefano, and Jorge.